So we will do this in sort of three parts. I will talk about the principles. Dr. Kirti Sabnis will talk about, you know, the infectious disease aspect of it. Dr. Akshay Deshpande will talk about the plastic surgery, and then we'll share some cases. So what we want to kind of talk over here is, one, how do we diagnose infected non-union? What studies are useful? What is the overall management scheme, and how do you stage this? And can you do implant retention in cases of infection? So there are two parts to it. One is the treatment of the infection. And I always say, even if you can convert an infected non-union to a non-union, that is a partial success, and it's not a failure. For non-union, you need all of the concepts that we talk about: alignment, stability, biology, and function. We don't talk of superficial and deep infection, acute or chronic infection. These are two areas where you can go and get more information. It's called now FRI, fracture-related infection. And on the AO site, you have webinar recordings of very good webinars on that, as well as the annual report of the AO Foundation. There's a lot of good literature which has gone into great depths in relation to fracture-related infection. So you need, of course, a high degree of suspicion. With the medical history and the clinical exam, the only confirmatory criteria, according to what they have described, is a fistula or a sinus due to wound breakdown and a purulent discharge or a pus. All of the other things that we usually talk about are actually suggestive criteria. So this is when you are taking a history and doing the examination. So essentially, what you need is a very high index of suspicion. These are the various investigations that you can use to further elucidate your diagnosis or your suspicion. And then you need to go in and have a look at it if you have multiple suggestive signs with a surgical exploration. At least two swabs or two specimens coming out positive, histopath examination showing a positive signs for infection, and 5 PMNs per HPF. These are supposed to be now the confirmatory signs for infection. But even if there is, especially in our situation, when patients have been bombarded with antibiotics, if there is even a single one, that can be taken as a suspicion. So in combination of all of this, you come to the diagnosis of an FRI. And this is the algorithm that they've given. But what has been underlined in multiple articles that I have read is, one, the concept of a multidisciplinary team. The day when the orthopedic surgeon was king and could decide what antibiotic, or your favorite physician who looks at the cardiac issues and the pulmonary issues, probably is not necessarily the right person to advise you with what antibiotics to take. And therefore, an infectious disease specialist becomes an important part of this long-term plan that you need to make as to how you are going to approach. And this plan needs change depending on what is happening. One of the cases that we are discussing, we'll show you. So with this, the patient can undergo staged surgical procedures. And at the end, even before the discharge, sometimes you may need to put the patient on long-term antibiotics or some form of monitoring. Now, should you remove the implant or retain it? That depends on whether the construct is stable, how soon or late after the infection has the patient come to you, what is the host physiology, what is the anatomic location, is the soft tissue envelope good, and can you do a good debridement? So you can do it in a single stage or two stage. When they are presenting late, it's better to do it in two stage with some form of temporary stabilization and local antibiotics. But generally remember that there is a higher rate of failure with an IM nail versus a plate. the sooner you do it, the better. Less than 3 weeks, there's a 90% success. And this probably relates to the age of the biofilm. Using a local antibiotic depot of various types is a good idea. And when you are doing a DAIR, then it's good to have a 12 weeks of antibiotics. So getting the non-union to heal, when not to do a retention of the implant, when there is a late presentation, when you have poor local conditions, either skin and soft tissue, organisms are resistant. If you have a length discrepancy, if there's a gap, if there's a deformity, and if your fragments are small. So this patient came to us with a discharging sinus from the left thigh with an extension lag, quads power 3, more from, not from any neurological cause, but she hadn't been exercising. And this was the whole sort of story of what had happened to her. This is how she came to us. And she was showing signs of healing. Her markers were all kind of within limit, and she wasn't terribly ill. So this was a clinically quiescent infection. Healing was progressing. So we decided to stop the antibiotics and see. If the infection flares up, then we treat it as an infection. Otherwise, if healing progresses and she is lucky, we remove the plate. So that's her few weeks down the line. Her discharge had slightly increased. We had done a PET CT to show that that infection is pretty localized in relation to the plate. And when she came back with a sinus, we then decided to take this out and clean it up and put in internal fixation again. So that's what we did. She had a little soakage. Again, that has to be treated aggressively. Open it, debride it. This was a new plate, not the old one, and with antibiotic stimulan and a corrugated drain. So over time, with the antibiotic, her CRP has come to normal. And at 3.5 months, that is how she looked. At 10 months, that is how she was fully healed, functional. She had osteoarthritis, because of which she has that lurch. So clearance of infection by debridement, isolate the organisms, and then give antibiotics accordingly. Local antibiotic depot is a good thing. Alignment, stability, contact, these are all the principles of treating a non-union. And as I said, it's a good idea to read articles on the web for more information on fracture-related infection. Thank you.